soon takes place between 6 p.m. and 7 p.m.
It's Political Vindication Radio.
We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Who sees firsthand the concrete and mortar, the guard posts and machine gun towers, the dog runs and the barbed wire, can ever again take for granted his or her freedom or the precious gift that is America.
All this stuff you've heard about America not wanting to fight, wanting to stay out of the war, a lot of horse dung. Americans love to fight. All real Americans love staying in battle.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
Welcome to Political Vindication Radio, your guiding light through the Obama malaise years. This is PoliticalVindication.com on the air, and my name is Frank, also known as Uncle Seth the Devil.
And my name is Shane, also known as Ever Vigilant.
Tonight, author, commentator, filmmaker, and political provocateur John Ziegler joins us to talk about media bias in the American political discourse. Mr. Ziegler is the creator of the documentary Media Malpractice, How Obama Got Elected and Palin Was Targeted. He has called the media not only an institution that is biased in favor of the liberal establishment, but has gone so far as to say that a media that is so decisively one-sided puts the very fabric of our democracy at risk. It's his passions that drive him and his conviction that makes him such an inspiration to many of us on the right side of the political landscape. John Ziegler joins us tonight on Political Vindication Radio.
And that's why we appreciate people like the man that we have as a guest tonight. Mr. Ziegler, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, man, I first started listening to you when you were a host, 640 KFI out here in Los Angeles. And you were awesome, man. Prodding the comfortable, angering all the elites out here. Great radio. And I think that kind of energy you bring, we love that stuff here. You're the creator of the documentary Media Malpractice, How Obama Got Elected, Palin Was Targeted. And more important, your lights out in front of a camera when you go to all these shows, these liberal shows like we've been talking about here, whether it's The View, whether it's Schuster, whether it's Contessa Brewer. Man, how do you get ready for a show like that, Mr. Ziegler, going on there? I mean, it's got to be a battle, and you know it's a battle. They hate you.
Well, it depends on, obviously, the nature of the show, but it does take a lot of preparation because you really, as a conservative, start off with 2.5 strikes against you. So you have to have everything cornered. You have to anticipate every move they're going to make. And because you're basically starting with two hands tied behind your back, and in some cases, two hands and a leg. You've mentioned, MSNBC and some of the battles I've had there, which people can check out at the website howobamagotelected.com and in the news section at howobamagotelected.com. And one of the things that people don't realize about that is that when I do MSNBC, I do it from the Burbank Bureau, which, happens to be the exact same desk where Brian Williams does the NBC Nightly News whenever he does it from Los Angeles. So you would think it was, you would think it would be pretty high tech, and yet it has one of the worst delays that I have ever experienced in television. I've done a lot of satellite television, and for some reason it has an incredible delay. And that makes it even more difficult. And, in fact, that has caused part of the Contessa Brewer interview problem that you referred to, where she ended up cutting off my microphone, occurred in at least in part because of that delay, where we are responding to different things than what it appears we're actually responding to. And so it's just typical of NBC. I mean, they're completely incompetent, and they're biased, and they can't even set up a satellite uplink properly. So, but it's never easy. Sometimes it's fun, but I don't think you're going to be seeing me there very much in the future.
Mr. Ziegler, this is Frank. I want to welcome you to Political Vindication Radio. I want to ask you about the state of journalism in America today. Do you believe
the state of what?
The state of journalism. Journalism.
What is that?
Yeah, that's a great question. What is that? Some have proclaimed the death of journalism in this country.
Could you? Is that a word that's in the dictionary? Because I'm unfamiliar. Even though I live in Los Angeles, I only speak one language, and it's English. So I'm unfamiliar with that term.
Yeah, I know. I can understand that, actually. But I guess here's the question that I'm asking is that journalism, if you could kind of work through that, do people enter the field of journalism, do you believe, generally speaking, enter the field of journalism as liberals, or do you think it's something that evolves that the job requires of them?
Well, first of all, nobody goes into journalism anymore. I mean, they go into media, which is basically, you know, a college graduate's more dignified version of reality television. It's just an attempt by people without talent to become famous. That's really what it is. And, you know, that trumps everything now. You know, journalism hasn't existed on television since, you know, the moment that whoever it was put makeup on for the first time. You know, the first man to put makeup on television, that was pretty much the slippery slope that ended journalism on television. And, you know, now it's all hot babes. I mean, Fox News Channel is brilliant in that, and it gives you non-liberal news and hot babes at all times.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
true.
And that's why they're a ratings winner. That's why they figured it out.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. It's funny because the Golf Channel has adopted almost the same philosophy, which is, you know, if Fox News philosophy is, if we're talking conservative politics with hot babes at all times, we'll keep a certain amount of the audience. And the Golf Channel feels the same way. If we're talking golf with hot babes, we'll keep a certain amount of the same. It's the exact same demographic, by the way. You know, 45 to 55-year-old upscale males. You know, it's basically an excuse for men to be able to watch pornography without actually watching pornography. And so that when the wife says, "What are you watching?" "Well, I'm watching Fox News," or "I'm watching the Golf Channel." Well, no, you're not really. You're masturbating in your mind. But I mean, it's socially acceptable for you to watch Fox. "I'm watching the news." No, you're not. You're watching Megyn Kelly. That's not watching the news. And Megyn Kelly, by the way, happens to be one of the better news people among the hot babes that there are. But anyway,
well,
I mean, I don't think television news doesn't exist, and real news or real journalism is being destroyed by the internet, because, you know, newspapers, even though they're incredibly liberal, have basically done real journalism over the years, but now there's nobody left to do it because it doesn't make sense financially. And to answer your very serious and important question, which comes first, the chicken or the egg, I think it's a little bit of both. The nature of the type of person who decides to want to go into that endeavor tends to be more liberal. And then once they're in that endeavor, well, first of all, and then everyone making the decision as to who gets in the club is liberal. And then once you get in the club and everyone is liberal, you don't want to rock the boat. And you don't talk to anybody that's not a liberal, so you think that anyone that's not a liberal is an idiot. So, I mean, this is the world these people live in. They really, truly live in a world where they think that, you know, Newt Gingrich or Sarah Palin are completely outside of rational thought. I mean, they're in the hinterlands. Because they don't know anybody that believes those things. And in fact, they don't know anybody that's pro-life. I mean, that's why they look at pro-lifers as nut jobs, because there is – and I actually had this conversation with Chris Matthews once, not on air, off air. And Chris Matthews, you know, as liberal as they get, would openly acknowledge he has never met a pro-life woman in the media. Never.
Incredible.
Never. Chris Matthews. I mean, and he openly, in fact, he thought it was funny. He thought it was funny that he's never met a pro-life woman in the news media. Doesn't exist.
It's incredible. When you see, but when we talk about bias in media, whether it's cable news, it's Fox, they'll say Fox is a conservative news outlet.
I get mocked by the left when I say this, but I don't think Fox is that ideologically driven. I wish Fox was ideologically driven. I think Fox, obviously Hannity is way to the right. Glenn Beck is just nuts as far as I'm concerned, and right now he's way libertarian, and I'm a libertarian, but I don't trust Glenn Beck as far as I can throw him. Bill O'Reilly, you know, tends to be more libertarian, but he's all, you know, he would switch in a moment if it helped his ratings. And then their news, certainly it's not liberal. It's certainly right of center. It acknowledges that pro-life people exist and that kind of thing. But more than anything else, Fox News Channel is driven by what people want to watch, whether that's hot babes or missing attractive white teenagers. I mean, that's, you know, I will never forgive Fox News Channel for throwing the Iraq War under the bus for Natalie Holloway, but that's what they did. I mean, we lost the Iraq War in the public persona or perception in large part because Fox News Channel decided, you know what, we can do better in the ratings going after Natalie Holloway than we can talking about the Iraq War. And we never heard about the Iraq War after that.
John, that's a perfect segue into what I really want to talk to you about. You wrote about Palin and her treatment by the media, global warming. We're going through a hysteria. I think it's a hysteria with Toyota. Now the media, John, is it malice? Are they just a monster? What is it here with the media? Because I don't want to take it personal, and sometimes I wonder if there's a bias, if there's a liberal bias.
There's a lot of biases in the media. There are a lot of them.
Right.
And the number one bias by far in the news media is ratings, the ratings bias.
Right.
That is by far number one, and it's becoming a larger number one every single day. I see it. I mean, I guess you say you guys are here in Los Angeles, right?
Yeah.
I watch the local news from time to time, and I haven't had a chance to do it yet, but I actually fully intend at some point to call the news director, whoever that person is, at Channel 4 NBC News here, and I use that term very loosely, because something has happened just in the last month or two where they have left the gravitational pull of the earth when it comes to what is classified as news. Let me give you an example, and it's going to sound like it's, you know, a small example, but I think we can extrapolate out here what I'm talking about with regard to the ratings pressure. And you know what? The only thing I can come up with, by the way, is what their motivation is, that I think that they must have been so spooked by what happened when Jay Leno went to 10 o'clock and their lead-in for 11 destroyed their ratings, and now they're just playing catch-up, and they just don't give a damn. Because I was watching the 5 o'clock news on the NBC affiliate in Los Angeles, which used to be a very reputable news organization, and for 1 hour and 6 minutes, from 5 o'clock to 6:06, one Friday night, there was not one pre-planned news story that did not involve a celebrity. And I'm not exaggerating that. I'm not making it up. I charted it. It was un-freaking believable. An hour and 6 minutes. So it doesn't matter. News does. And by the way, you know what the news story was that broke the streak? It was the unemployment rate in California, which they devoted 30 seconds to, which they immediately followed up with a story on Hollywood's unemployed. This is what has happened. There are no repercussions anymore for news organizations abandoning principles and guidelines and standards for ratings. And so they do it, and they do it with impunity, and they do it with Sarah Palin. That's what my God, MSNBC would be out of business without Sarah Palin. They would be. They would just fold up the tent. They would have nothing to talk about if it was not for Sarah Palin, because she is ratings gold, and that's all that matters. It's all that matters. Now, the liberal bias comes in second, but the ratings bias trumps everything, and that's why the Palin phenomenon and the Obama phenomenon were so dramatic, because they combined both. They combined the ratings bias with the liberal bias, and then look out when that happens.
So it's a race to a baser instincts then. It's just a race to the bottom.
Oh, there's no stopping it now. There is no stopping it. I mean, I fully expect that, you know, the NBC Nightly News will look like Access Hollywood in 3 years. I mean,
now why?
It already does to a certain extent. I mean, the difference between Access Hollywood and Extra and the Nightly News is already scarily small. There's almost no difference. I mean, there is no difference between the local news, at least here in Los Angeles, and Access Hollywood and Extra. None. I mean, it's really amazing. And I think, you know, it's been the ultimate slippery slope. I think, by the way, we went down the slope a huge amount during the Tiger Woods situation. I mean, when you have the New York Post put Tiger Woods on the cover of that newspaper 20 consecutive days, which is absurd to begin with, and when you consider that it broke the previous record for any other story, which was 19, which was 9/11, then you know everything you need to know. I mean, especially when the story had no New York connection. I mean, there was no New York element to the story, really. I think one of his mistresses might have been from there. But, I mean, you know, and I'm as big a Tiger – used to be as big a Tiger Woods fan as anybody that there is, and I'm as interested in the story as anybody is, but that's ridiculous. That's not – that was not worthy of 20 consecutive front-page stories in the New York Post. But the only reason it was because people were buying it. That's the only thing that matters. Now, it's always been the case that mattered. It always mattered more than anyone was willing to admit, but now it's the only thing that matters, and that's where we're in real trouble.
Well, we've gone from a time where our media would not report on our president's dalliances, and that's JFK, to a time now where it's all sex and excitement on our news, our supposedly objective.
Yeah, you know, it would be interesting.
Why is that happening, John? Why
well,
is that?
You know, if JFK was around today, it would be interesting. I mean, obviously he is. His name's Obama. You know, I mean, you know.
Would they report on Obama? Would they report?
You know, I don't think they would. You know, I really don't think they would. I think that in that case, I think the standard of proof would be unbelievably high. Unbelievably high. Because there you've got, you know, it's almost like a card game. You got the liberal bias combined with the pro-black bias, or the fear of offending black people bias, and that trumps the ratings bias. So those two cards together, in this case, especially with their boy Obama, I think that they would need an unbelievable amount of proof, and it would have to be somehow relevant to go after Obama. And I have I certainly have no belief that he's doing anything untoward. You know, I think Michelle probably would take care of him if he did. But you know, that's not the point. The point is, are we living in an age where they would even report it if they knew it? And I don't think they would. I really don't. I think they're so protective of this guy, and they'd be so afraid of perpetrating, you know, black stereotypes or whatever that I don't think they would do it.
But there's clearly some media outlets out there like the New York Times and CNN and especially a lot of the major newspapers, their numbers, their circulation numbers, ratings numbers are dwindling. Is that because they're not giving people what they want, or is that other reasons, maybe political reasons, biases maybe, you think?
Oh, I wish it was because of bias, but it's not really because of bias. No, it's simply a technological thing. I mean, people are getting their news from other sources. I mean, you know, and their audience is dying every day. You know, the New York Times audience dies. It's like the radio audience is dying. And so, I mean, it's just a matter of time. I mean, it's just a medium that's past its time. And so, you know, I think the New York Times, I think newspapers are in big, big trouble. I happen to think this is somewhat off the subject, but by coincidence, I happen to have gone to a speech given by one of the muckety mucks at Sports Illustrated last week here in Los Angeles. And he was talking about how in 5 years there will be no Sports Illustrated magazine, that they're just going to go simply to a tablet, basically, that you get on a computer. And I thought thought the guy was completely delusional to think that Sports Illustrated could survive like that, because I think Sports Illustrated, the power in it is the who's on the cover every week, the holding it in your hand, seeing the photograph, having that actually matter on a week-to-week basis. Now, there are very, very, very few publications that fit into that category, but if even Sports Illustrated is willing to admit that there's not going to be a magazine in 5 years, the New York Times has no chance, and neither does any other newspaper. And I don't think that once it's only an internet entity, then, my gosh, especially if you're under the age of 30, what's the difference between the New York Times and the Huffington Post? Nothing. In fact, you think the Huffington Post is more important because it's been cooler. I don't see how the New York Times survives. Now, that's a good thing. You know, eliminating the Times and the Post as having a stranglehold over the agenda. And make no mistake, the New York Times' real power is that every single member of the news media reads it in the Northeast Corridor every day, and that's what dictates what stories they cover. That is true. It's not as true as it used to be, but it's still very true. So the fact that that's going to end is good. But what's not good, and I believe Obama's election changed everything here, and that's why I did this documentary, Media Malpractice, and why we did How Obama Got Elected.com, because there was a sea change here. And that was that Obama's campaign allowed all of these entities that had always held back at least a little bit, because they had some sense of decorum, some sense of standards, some sense of, gee, we couldn't possibly get away with you know, letting our hair down and telling people what we really believe and having that impact our alleged journalism, could we? Well, we got the answer in 2008. They decided, all right, the dam is broken, and Katie barred the door, and we're going to let it all hang out. And they got away with it, and they won. So, you know, that precedent has now been set, and that's going to be the way it'll be forever now. So that's a huge part of why I made the documentary.
Well, Rupert Murdoch says the iPad is the greatest new thing. I mean, he's awful. I was into an interview with him the other day, John, and the guy was just crazy about it.
Well, maybe it will be, but, I mean, I'm not sure how that saves newspapers.
The world is changing. Information is changing. You're talking about talk radio. Are people moving to the internet? And in that case, John, is that tailor-made for folks like yourself?
No. I mean, you know, talk radio, unfortunately. See, and I wrote about this in my last book, The Death of Free Speech. One of the worst things that's happened to this country, and no one's really been willing to acknowledge it, is the fragmentation of our news media. And talk radio is a perfect example of this. We're so fragmented now that nobody has the same experience. I mean, heck, I mean, people who watch MSNBC all day and people who watch Fox News all day might as well be living in completely different countries. I mean, they can't even have a conversation. They literally cannot have a conversation and these are people who actually are probably in the top 5% of the educated people as far as what's going on in the world, because at least they're watching something that's allegedly news, as opposed to, you know, the 500 channels of cotton candy that are out there. So, now there's satellite radio and, you know, every different flavor of talk radio you could get and all that, and you know, none of it has any impact at all. I mean, one of the things that I laugh about, and I think conservatives need to be understand, conservatives don't seem to understand that Fox News Channel and talk radio only influence about 30% of the adult population. That's about it, at most, that are even exposed to anything on talk radio or Fox News Channel. And so 70% have no idea of anything that's happening that's not on those two entities. I laugh that we think that the Acorn thing was such a great victory. All right, really? The vast majority of the country had no idea about the story. Turns out that the editing that got Acorn in trouble was fraudulent, and they one of the filmmakers is under a felony indictment for another matter. I mean, this is a victory? this is the best we can do. I mean, the reality is that things are not nearly as good for the conservative side right now as they appear to be. And I also laugh when people say, well, my gosh, Obama's down to 48% approval in the Gallup poll. He's only barely over a year into his presidency. This is fantastic. Really? So you're thrilled that after the worst year he could possibly have with a horrendous economy and nothing going right, his approval ratings are still above where they were for George Bush when he got reelected. You're happy about that. Yeah, that's fantastic. So, I mean, he is still, in my opinion, a heavy, heavy favorite to be reelected for a number of reasons.
Sure. What about the Tea Party movement? What is that a reflection of?
I think the Tea Party movement is great in many ways. I'm a libertarian conservative. Philosophically, I think I'm right in line with most Tea Partiers. I'm glad that it's an occurring. I'm glad it's happened. I think it's significant. However, I think in some ways it's overrated. I think in some element, and this is another perfect example, the fragmentation. There is no Tea Party. The Tea Party is made up of a ton of different organizations, some of which, I'll tell you right now, are corrupt, are absolutely corrupt, and I know them to be corrupt. And they're run by people who don't give a damn about the movement. They're only worried about lining their pockets or making themselves famous for 15 minutes or whatever it is. And it's an absolute disgrace. And so as far as how potent a political force they are, these people didn't come from Mars. It's not like after the 2008 election we had an influx of several million libertarian conservatives that suddenly landed on the planet. That didn't happen. These are mostly people who probably have already voted in the past. They're just becoming more vocal about it. And I would be really surprised. To me, the perfect example is what happened in the New York congressional district with Hoffman. I mean, we're supposed to get all excited because the Tea Party candidate ended up getting 48% of the vote. But what people forget there is a Democrat won that district for the first time in over a century. So, I mean, where was the big? Where were the floodgates of these new voters? They weren't there. I mean, it's just basically, to me, it's a civil war within the Republican Party. That's really all it is.
Is great, John. That needs to happen. That needs to happen. And so you try to create momentum, and you're creating momentum with.
Well, look. By the way, the best thing about the Tea Party movement is that it has created the perception of momentum.
Right.
And that's great because perception becomes reality. And so maybe people who wouldn't ordinarily get involved are getting involved, and that's great.
That's a start of something.
Right. Well, maybe, but it's not. It is not this earthquake or this tidal wave that some people would have you believe. I mean, and look, I'm someone who believes the Republicans are going to win pretty large in 2010, but it's mainly because the economy sucks. It's not going to get any better by then, and Democrats are doing everything they possibly can to screw, to blow this politically. So, but it's not because all of a sudden, and I've told Sarah Palin this via email. I doubt she agrees with me because she seems to be very enamored with the Tea Party movement, and I think she's a little naive about it because I think she likes to believe the best in people.
Yeah.
But the reality is the world has not changed dramatically since 2008. The United States of America did not by accident give 52.5% of their votes to an avowed socialist. Okay? They didn't happen by accident. Now, there are some people who were duped, no question about it. The Peggy Noonans of the world, the David Brooks of the world, David Frums of the world, all the alleged Republicans who wanted to ingratiate themselves with the news media that frankly ought to be, I think, hung by their toenails. for having done so. Unfortunately, we're very lousy in our movement when it comes to defending our warriors and punishing our traitors, which disgusts me. But there were some people who were duped, but that number was not that large. It might have been 5%, which means, we still got over 47% of people who were thrilled to vote for a socialist. I just don't see how the world has changed. Now, if Obama was running for re-election today, he would have to run against a lousy candidate to win. But he's not running today. He's running in 2.5 years. And my guess is that things can't get any worse for him economically between now and then. Maybe they can, but I doubt it. And if the economy improves at all, he's a lock. He's an absolute lock to be reelected.
John, let's take a quick phone call. We've got an old voice we haven't heard from in a while on the line. Let's see if I can get this to work here. Fred, are you with us?
Oh, hey, guys. Yeah, this is Fred. I come from New York. I also go by I Got My Reasons. How's it going tonight?
Excellent. Good, good. What's on your mind, man?
I almost forgot because I was just listening to your guest, but I called in earlier about the stuff about the news being driven by what people want to hear or see, rather, and I think I'm in total agreement with him. I'm coming from left of spectrum. I write a blog at Talking Points Memo. Sometimes I go after the Times occasionally for it being sort of right of center on something. I can give you an example. When they wrote a story about Glenn Beck and how he was starting to do activism.
Right.
And this is only about 4 months ago.
Right.
And the entire article was basically Glenn Beck's press release, about his political, I guess he's doing these rallies where he's signing up voters, like Acorn style, right? And so they presented it as if this was new. They made no mention of the 9/12 movement or any of this other stuff that I knew about Glenn Beck just from,
How is that? That's the best you can come up with when it comes to right-wing bias of the New York Times?
Well,
Hold on. They do that for lefty organizations all the time. Al Sharpton would never get a crowd at one of his protests if not for entities like the New York Times taking almost literally his bullhorn and promoting whatever that cause is going to be. So the fact
that I never said that wasn't true. I'm simply saying that there's a trend now with the right and things like where they're afraid now to go after people on the right. That's all I'm saying. That was my question.
Well, I will say this. I didn't read the New York Times article about Glenn Beck, but Glenn Beck is a fraud. Right? Glenn Beck is a masterful fraud. He's a very talented fraud. He's an effective fraud in a lot of ways. And he might be better. There might be more pros than cons when it comes to the bottom line of Glenn Beck. But the reality is, not too long ago, Glenn Beck was an apolitical, seemingly liberal disc jockey who was an alcoholic in Louisville, Kentucky, and who decided as a career move that he was going to become a libertarian conservative talk show host. Now, he's very masterful at claiming that, well, I found God and I dumped alcohol and, that therefore anything that happened before then didn't count. But I'm a little more cynical than that, and I don't buy it from
George Bush.
Well, George Bush didn't completely change his politics. That's the difference, okay? I mean, I understand people like to have rebirths, and to a certain extent, you can, have a rebirth. But when it happens to coincide directly with a massive career change that ends up making you millions and millions of dollars and making you famous, call me skeptical. And I'm amazed more people are not, and I'm amazed more people don't know that. Did any of you guys know that was Glenn Beck's history?
I did.
Yeah.
Actually, can I ask you the question I was going to ask, or it's a question to the audience more?
Mm-hmm.
One of the stories that seemed to get lost in the shuffle of all this celebrity stuff is the Pentagon shooter story. Do you know about this?
What about it?
The story. I was wondering if you had
spit
heard
it out, Fred. Fred,
what?
Spit it out. Spit it out.
I just said it.
What's the question? What's the question? I mean, I know about the story. What is?
Well, the question is, it seemed to be a rather significant story about, another pseudo terrorist kind of thing.
And you're saying that it was downplayed.
It was downplayed sort of by default. It was in the news for like a day, and then it went away.
Well, I agree with you that stories like that. I couldn't agree more that I think anything that's related to seemingly terrorism. Now, you see, it's funny to me how we define what terrorism is. But, I mean, one of the reasons, I'll tell you why that story didn't go anywhere. The story didn't go anywhere because the guy died. And so, therefore, there's nothing else to the story. There's not going to be a trial. There's not going to be an interview. We're not going to find out exactly why he did it. He seemed to be troubled. People presume he was basically committing suicide, and so therefore there's nothing else to the story.
John, if I could say real quickly, what's happening with all these stories though is immediately they want to assign political motives. Okay, the Pentagon shooter, Tea Partier, right winger, guy flies his plane, and you read it, and you can read what the guy is up to, but still. The memo goes out, the template goes out, and all of a sudden you're going to assign political motives to everybody who does something.
Well, I will agree with this. I find it absolutely an abomination that anybody who does anything evil and who has and is considered remotely anti-government is automatically labeled right-wing, no matter what it is. And no matter what their true beliefs, no matter what their politics, no matter what their party affiliation, they're considered right-wing. I find that it's definitely one of the vehicles, one of the methods that the media uses to try to ostracize conservatives from the mainstream. There's no doubt about that.
Well, they did it to Sarah Palin.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was a public...
It was an assassination.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, that's what it was. And by the way, I mean, I've taken heat recently for writing that, obviously I've devoted most of my life over the last year and a half to this documentary media malpractice, going around the country screening it, promoting it on radio and television, putting a lot of my own money into it. So I couldn't be, my street cred on this issue couldn't be higher. But I think it's important that we as conservatives acknowledge that as unjust as that assassination was, that it did take place, and so she is, at least temporarily, and at least against Barack Obama, and at least in 2012, she is politically dead when it comes to a presidential race. And to pretend that that's not the case is counterproductive. And I've told her this as well, which I'm sure didn't make me very popular in the Palin household. But you know what? She may already understand this. She may be playing a game. She may be using the news media for her own purposes, which would be rather ironic and a bit of poetic justice, because the reality is she may already understand she's not going to run for president, but she's smart enough to understand you don't say that because then people start to treat you differently if they don't think you're a potential presidential candidate. I am very much against Sarah Palin running in 2012. I think she ought to wait till 2016, and I think she could be a heck of a candidate then.
Yeah. Well, John, you've interviewed her. I guess one of the big knocks we see in the mainstream media about Sarah Palin to the left often uses is her lack of intelligence, to be nice, I guess. You've met her. What are your general thoughts when you hear that by the mainstream media?
Yeah, well, it's ridiculous. All anyone has to do, first of all, is just watch my interview with her, which you can do if you get our DVD at howobamagotelected.com, the entire uncut, and that's very unusual to see Sarah Palin uncut, 45-minute interview is a special feature on the DVD. And the reality is that she's incredibly smart, very engaging, very funny. I hit her with a lot of things she had never seen before, and yet she did extraordinarily well. Mm-hmm. And but here's my proof on this. And one of these days, hopefully I'll get a chance to say this on national TV. I'm supposed to go on with Scarborough again at some point to debate this very issue. And if I do, this is what I'm going to say, which is really. So let's take a look at at somebody you think is incredibly intelligent. Would you accept the notion that Peggy Noonan is incredibly intelligent? Oh, Peggy Noonan. Oh, Reagan's speechwriter. She talks so good, and she's obviously so intelligent. Okay, and Sarah Palin, obviously an idiot, right? Oh, my God, Sarah Palin, an idiot. Well, the two biggest decisions that anybody in the political realm has had to make over the last several years were the following. Is Barack Obama a fraud, and is global warming a fraud? And on both of those cases, the brilliant Peggy Noonan was 0-2, and Sarah Palin was 2-2. Who's the idiot there? That's the bottom line.
That is, and you know, again, I'll say, John, as we kind of wrap things up, that's what I appreciate so much about you. You go on to these shows where it's going to be hostile, but you keep your composure. Maybe I assume that's years of being behind a microphone, years of dealing with people. You go to USC, you're facing down David Keene. I mean, you do things that in many ways you're tested, your knowledge tested of the issues, you're tested under pressure, and you're awesome. It's like watching Michelle Malkin in action, too. I was so impressed with her when she came out after her book and started making her rounds on there and just getting jumped on, and she performed beautifully. You do the same thing. You have the same charisma and the patience, and you're deadly.
Yeah, well, that's
not gonna.
But you
practice in front of the mirror, John? Or
it's not going to get my career anywhere because, you know, Michelle Malkin, God bless her, has the advantage of being an attractive Asian woman, and so therefore she will always have a career. As another white male, I have no career, so it's a lot easier to say these things when you have no career.
I totally disagree with you. John Ziegler, I've been putting his website link in the chat room all during this interview. He's awesome. He's a fighter. He's a provocateur. He asks questions, and he gives answers that might make people uncomfortable, but it's the truth, and that's why we appreciate you and respect you, Mr. Ziegler. Thank you for coming on Political Vindication
Radio.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you,
John.
I just love that.
Yeah,
Frank. I mean, mm-hmm. You know what? You can understand why the guy pisses off people on all sides of the spectrum.